is, of course, Shadi Hamid of the Brookings Institute. You flew into Cairo just a few days ago. Yeah. Moments ago, that's where you were, in the middle of the crowd. What was the sense? I know you left just moments before that announcement.
Yeah, well, I was there just about 30 minutes ago. It was still tense. There was a lot of uncertainty. What's going to happen next? No one was sure. And after the disappointment of last night, you know, people were worried that things would only get worse. But I come into the hotel, and then I start hearing, beeping and cheering, and look outside, and then I hear that the announcement was made that Mubarak is, in fact, stepping down. It's remarkable, really. I mean, there's really no words to describe it.
Shadi, I mean, put in perspective for me, beyond just a president leaving office who has ruled this country for 30 years, what that departure will mean, what having the military in charge is likely to mean for all of these people.
Yeah, sure. Well, first of all, I mean, many of the people in the square right now have never lived under another president. We're talking about 30 years here. So this is someone who's been the symbol of the nation for so long. And to see him leave, it totally shifts the psychology of all of this. Mm-hmm. That said, a military coup is not the same thing as democracy, and that's what we have here. The military is taking over. That doesn't mean the protesters' demands are going to be met immediately. The military is not a pro-democracy organization. Omar Suleiman, the vice president, who may become the president now, does not have much democratic credentials. Mm-hmm. So there's still a lot of uncertainty about what this means. How does the military actually feel about governing? Does it want to hand it over to a civilian government as soon as possible? Will it wait? We don't know.
So to call this a true revolution would be overstating it. This is the culmination of an uprising. We're not seeing a true change of life in Egypt.
Not yet. So I think this is either the end of the beginning or the beginning of the end, but there's still a lot more that Egypt is going to have to go through to actually see a real democratic transition. And let's not forget, that's what these people really want. Mubarak is a major part of that, but it's not as if right when he leaves, Egypt is going to reach some kind of utopia. So I'm worried a little bit. I see the euphoria here in the square, and people should be happy, they should be thrilled after what they've sacrificed. But I'm just worried that we're getting a little bit ahead of ourselves right now.
No, and it's a fair point to have the perspective of what's next. There haven't been institutions really allowed to develop in terms of political opposition in a real way. Those mechanisms that you take for granted in a democracy haven't been allowed to really take root here. So the question is also, if Omar Suleiman is president, does that mean that this newly appointed cabinet remains to get this country back online, the economy functioning again?
I mean, no one really knows. What does a military takeover really mean in practice? Does that mean they're going to appoint new cabinet ministers? Who's actually going to be governing? Omar Suleiman, or Omar Suleiman and a group of people around him, senior military officers? Again, I mean, this is totally unprecedented. We have no precedent for what's happening right now. So everyone's just kind of learning on the go. We'll just have to wait and see. And I'm really curious to see what the next details will be coming from this so-called military council.
Give me a sense as well of, you know, this was about, for so many people, creating a better life. But in the meantime, life has come to a halt in the past few weeks here. The damage that's been done in terms of economic activity, if we project out, that's going to create more joblessness. That's going to create, in the near term, a life that makes it harder to afford everyday goods, food to put on the table. So does this become another crisis? What is the next stage in this as a political scientist?
Well, sure. I mean, the rebuilding stage is what we're going to enter right now. And as you're saying, the economy has lost billions of dollars. Egypt has come to a standstill. And people really are ready to go back to normal life and start the difficult work of trying to move forward and rebuilding their country. So, I mean, that's what people are looking for, how long it takes and the struggle they have to go through to get to that point.
It's all projections at this point, but I know in talking to so many of the economists, they say, you know, $12 billion in the Egyptian economy in terms of economic activity comes from tourism, of course. You know, history really, the crown export and jewel of this country. And the projection was by September, by the elections, tourism will start coming back. But as you say, what does a military in power look like? Can you really assume that the world that's watching tanks in the streets, the world that's watching this protest, feels comfortable? comfortable to help, you know, sort of provide the grease to the Egyptian economic engine.
Right. If we're talking about a military regime, that's going to make the international community nervous. I mean, just seeing the way Egypt is the last few days, there are tanks everywhere, there are soldiers everywhere.
And yet, it's a Egyptian military with very strong ties to the U.S. I mean, Defense Secretary Cohen, who we speak to frequently on the show, keeps saying, you know, we train with them, we deal with them, we sell them a heck of a lot of arms. So is it an unfriendly military that you're talking about?
Well, the U.S. is the primary benefactor of the Egyptian military, and that's an important side story here. If we're trying to understand why the military maybe moved in this direction, we can imagine that there was a lot of prodding coming from the Defense Department in Washington, coming from the U.S. military,
right,
saying, first of all, don't use any force on these protesters. That's number one. But also, the Obama administration was caught off guard last night. Obama, the CIA, everyone thought it was going to happen last night. And I think there was probably a lot of frustration and anger in the State Department, in the Defense Department, that we were still at a standstill last night. And from what I understand, there were calls back and forth earlier this morning between Defense Department and their counterparts here in Egypt, and I'm sure they made that very clear.
Shadi Hamid and I have been standing here. Shadi's from the Brookings Institute, and we were trying to make out what they were saying, and you can't.
It just sounds like a roar.
It's a cacophony of voices, people just shouting and celebrating right now. But you were down in the midst of the square, and how, over the past few days, do you think the tone has changed? I mean, did this have to be the breaking point?
You know, I think everyone felt that the time had come, and this was going to be the decisive point. The military has to make its choice. Will it side with the people and push Mubarak out, or will it side with Mubarak? And I think now we have our answer, but up until now there were a lot of big question marks, and there still are, about the role of the military. But it's just very interesting how fluid the situation is. It's gone from fear to jubilation to disappointment to concern, and now, again, to celebration.
Mm-hmm.
And it's just incredible just to see the kind of the emotion rising up here.
It really is, and it's hard to put it in perspective because tonight is a night of celebration. But if we can, in some ways, I mean, does this mean that not only are we passing, obviously, a massive moment in Egyptian history, but a change in the consciousness, not only throughout the Arab world, but perhaps among political scientists like yourself? I mean, what is it? Have you been underestimating the demographics here? How much it matters to have such a large percentage of the population under the age of 30 and not having, real access to jobs?
Well, I think as political scientists, we're going to spend a lot of the coming months trying to understand what happened here, really.
Why was this unexpected?
Well, I think people knew the explosion was going to happen sooner or later, but I think we were caught by surprise about how quickly it actually happened. I think after Tunisia, there was a sense that things were really changing in the region, but Egypt didn't seem a very prime candidate for immediate change. But Egyptians have surprised the world, and they've shown that, you know, they can take matters into their own hands. They don't have to wait for the international community. They don't have to wait for the U.S. They can just go out into the streets and say, this is what we want, and there's strength in numbers. When you have hundreds of thousands of people in the streets, the regime can't stop them. There's just too many. You can't arrest 10,000 people in a square.
Well, what some would say differentiates this from what we saw play out in the streets of Iran, in Tehran, a few years ago, was that the military did not fire. It's really the role of the military that has decided things here, hasn't it?
Yeah, and the question is, how can the military fire into crowds of a million or more? And they know the world is watching, and I think the international community played a really important role here. The Western press was covering this wall to wall. The military isn't going to want to commit a massacre when everyone is watching, when the Obama administration is watching. And there is, as we mentioned earlier, a close relationship between the U.S. military and the Egyptian military. So, and I think the military, it rose to the occasion.
Mm.
It played an honorable role here. And I think
will
it has...
Will they now?
That's the big question. It's still too early to tell. But if we could just kind of freeze history right now, the military has the potential to be remembered as the force that made Egyptian democracy possible.
Mm.
If we freeze this moment. But we'll have to see what happens in the coming months.
The question of contagion keeps coming up among investors, among political scientists. I mean, next door, we saw King Abdullah of Jordan dismiss his cabinet, create a new government. Do we now ask, what happens tomorrow in Jordan, in Syria, in the Palestinian territories, really throughout the Arab world?
Well, that's a really interesting question here. There was always a sense that Tunisia was separate, that it was somewhat exceptional,
too far
and too remote. Egypt is the heart of the Arab world culturally and politically, and I think this is going to inspire the masses everywhere in the region. And if they had any doubts that this could happen in their own country, those doubts are now gone, because if it can happen in Egypt, which was known to have a strong and even in some ways ruthless regime, if it can happen here, why can't it happen somewhere else? And people are going to be talking about the January 25th revolution. Maybe it's not a true revolution just yet, but in the hearts and minds of the Egyptians and the Arab people, they're seeing this as a revolution.
Shadi, thank you so much.